Welcome to Faith Community Church of the Nazarene this morning. It's good to have you all here with us. Back where I come from, we have a tradition. Every other Sunday, we greet each other and we say hello, we say hi, we say Merry Christmas or whatever it is. But on Easter is a special day in the church. And so on Easter, we have a special greeting. Today we celebrate our resurrected Lord. And so today, the greeting is, He is risen. And the response is, He is risen indeed. So let's try that this morning. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Oh, you guys are good at this. Try that out. Everyone you meet today, announce that our Lord is risen. A couple announcements. I want to point out our visitor cards. You should have one in your bulletin. If you didn't get a bulletin, there are visitor cards in every row. This is how we can get to know you. We want to talk to you. We want to chat with you. We want to connect with you. But some things don't come up in conversation, like your address and your phone number typically. So this is one way that we can connect with you. And so I would encourage you, if you're a visitor today, to take some time and fill this out. There are pencils in the rows. And as the offering plates go by later, just toss it in the offering plate. And if you don't want us to contact you, there's a little checkbox down there at the bottom as well, and we will respect that. On the back side is our prayer card, because we believe in the power of prayer. And we want to be praying for you and with you, and we want to know how to do that. And so if you have a prayer request, I would ask that you fill it out on there. We'll pray for it in church. We'll send it out on our prayer chain. And so if you have a prayer request this morning, fill out the back on there. And again, toss it in the offering plate. And I would ask everybody to go ahead and, as the offering plates go by, to toss your visitor card and prayer card into the offering plate so that pretty much I don't have to come back and pick them up later. Nope, it's one card. It's just one card. Yep. There are lots of good announcements in the bulletin. I'm not going to point them all out. But I do want to announce that today, in our offering, every year we take a special offering. The church gives to it throughout the year, but on Easter, we take a special Easter offering for world evangelism. There's information on the little handout. I'm not going to read it to you, but this is one way that we can help spread the gospel, the good news that Jesus Christ has risen across the world. So as the ushers come later, if you have an Easter offering, I ask you to mark it as such, and we will get that sent off. And then every few weeks, I include one of these in your bulletins. Maybe you haven't seen it before. But just in case you haven't, I'm gonna fill you in a little bit. We believe that God speaks to us through His Word. That is one way that He communicates to us. His Word is breathing and living. And this is, many people don't know where to start. You know, with 66 books, it's a lot to take in. Where do you start reading? And so this is an opportunity to have a place to start. And this week, or this time, we have something special. This one is called the Heroes Reading Plan. We're reading about heroes in the Bible. And along with all the reading every day, if you download the church app, again, there's information at the bottom of the card. Just search Beulah Nazarene in your respective app store. You can subscribe to the daily Bible reading track. And all these Bible readings will be delivered right to your phone. And for this one, we have a very special, there will be videos along with them. So it's a great way to help introduce your kids to the Bible. We use it at night for our Bible reading before bed. So I would encourage you, download the church app and subscribe to the daily reading plan to get this on your phone. That is all the announcements that I have for this morning. And so at this time, if our ushers will come forward, we will receive our tithes and offerings and our annual Easter offering as well. Today we have a special privilege. You may be seated. Today we have a special privilege. This Easter holiday season celebration is a time in which we celebrate the new birth that we have through Christ Jesus. And so it is exciting today. I'm stumbling over my words. Because I'm excited because we have two people who have expressed interest in becoming a new creation through baptism today. If Greg Hoffner and Sherry Mayer would come forward, please. It is our privilege to have had them in our church for quite some time, and an extra special privilege to be celebrating with them today in their baptism. If their family would like to come forward as well, you might be able to get better pictures up here. Baptism is a sign and a seal of the new covenant of grace, the significance of which is attested by the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Romans, when he says, "Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we are united with him like this in death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection." The earliest and simplest testament of the Christian belief into which you now come to be baptized is the Apostles' Creed, which reads, "I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Church of Jesus Christ, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting." This is the faith that you are being baptized into. Will you be baptized into this faith? If so, answer, "I will." Do you acknowledge Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? And do you realize that he saves you even now? Will you obey God's holy will and keep his commandments, walking in them all the days of your life? If so, answer, "I will." If you would please kneel at the altars here. It is my privilege to be your pastor. It is my privilege to walk with you in this journey. Sherry Mayer, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Greg Hoffner, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, I praise you for the new life that you have given us. I thank you for your sacrifices and your mercies. Lord, may we walk with you daily, celebrating the new life that you have given us. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Congratulations. At this time, we'd like to enter into our time of prayer. When we go before our Father, our risen Lord and Savior, and lay before him the burdens of our hearts and our praises as well. We want to continue to pray for those with health needs, for those who are struggling, and the prayers that we have received this morning. So if you will bow your heads with me, let us approach the throne of grace in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we praise you on this glorious Easter morning. We praise you for the risen Savior, that death had no hold over you. Lord, you are not some dead historical figure, but you are alive and well, the living God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that we have hope, that death is not the end. But for, Lord, those who believe in you, you grant the privilege of eternal life. Lord, you are not only a distant God who has saved us once, but Lord, you are with us every step of the way. Lord, you watch over us and protect us. Lord, you are burdened with our burdens. And so, Lord, we lift up to you those burdens today. Lord, we lift up to you the orphans, those children without parents, or those who are separated from them. Lord, I pray that you bring restoration, that you bring healing. But Father, that you would be the best father that they ever had. Lord, we lift up Bernetta Sapp as she's continuing to go through treatments for cancer. Lord, I pray that you would be with her upcoming surgeries, and that you would continue the healing that you've already begun. I praise you for what you've done in her life. And Lord, we continue to pray for Hannah and David. And Lord, we ask for healing. We ask for restoration. Lord, you are the great physician, and we know that nothing is outside of your power. Lord, we pray for Trisha and Carly and Grant and Shayna and Kimberly. Lord, you know the details of every hurt, every sorrow, every trial that we are facing. So, Lord, we lay them at your feet. And we ask, Lord, for your direction, for your guidance, and for your comfort. Lord, we lift up those who are struggling with family problems, with financial problems. And Lord, those who are just lost. Lord, we pray that even now your Spirit is working in their lives, guiding them through your prevenient grace to a loving relationship with the Lord and Creator of this universe. Lord, I pray that you remind us this day of your glory and your power that brought Jesus Christ from the grave. Lord, may we walk in that power. May we find strength in your word. Lord, may your Spirit fall on this service this morning, opening our hearts and our minds to hear what you would have to say to us. We pray this in your holy, perfect, and matchless name, Lord. Amen. As we celebrate Easter today, it is a glorious day. It is a time when we can forget the world's problems and when we can just celebrate our Lord Jesus. But the truth is, there are many things in this world that divide us. There are family scuffles. There are a number of things that separate and divide us. But if there is one thing that unites all of mankind. It is the truth that the Star Wars prequels just weren't living up to the hype that everyone hoped that they were. I mean, the Star Wars prequels, they tried to do some good stuff. They generally get a bad rap. But they do a great service as well. I mean, they show us the path of Anakin Skywalker upon the realization in The Empire Strikes Back that he is Darth Vader, that he had once been a promising young Jedi, and that he is Luke Skywalker's father. Sorry for the spoilers, in case anyone hasn't seen them yet. But upon all of that, people began to ask the question, what does it take for a promising young Jedi to turn to the dark side and become the most ruthless and dangerous person in the galaxy? In episode 1, we learned that Anakin Skywalker was born on the desert planet of Tatooine. He had a deep attachment to his mother. They were slaves. And he wanted to do nothing more than to alleviate her pain and suffering. He built her a droid, which was no small task, especially for a child. However, despite all of his talents and skills in many areas, he was unable to free her from slavery. One day, a man came to them. This man, a Jedi Knight, had supernatural abilities. And he was able to free Anakin from his slave master. Yet, he was not able to save Anakin's mother. However, he did promise this young boy that he would teach him in the ways of the Force, that he would teach him to have all those same powers and knowledge. Essentially, he was promising to this young boy that he would someday be able to free his own mother. At least that's how a young boy in that circumstance would understand it. Fast forward a number of years, and Anakin has grown in knowledge and skill in the Force. Circumstances brought him back to that planet of Tatooine, and he sees the opportunity to free his mother. However, he is too late, and he watches as his mother dies in his arms. He had finally learned enough to rescue her from her slave master, but he was not able to rescue her from death. For a man who values these relationships above all else, this was devastating for him. He continues to pour himself into his studies, and he falls in love and secretly marries his childhood friend, Padme Amidala. However, not long after discovering that he will indeed become a father, Anakin is plagued by visions of Padme dying. Jedi are known to be able to have these glimpses of the future. Flashbacks of his mom begin to run through his mind again. He had lost her because he was not strong enough, because he didn't know enough, he wasn't powerful enough. And now he was in danger of losing Padme as well. At this point, along with a series of events, he decides that he knows what he must do. He is willing to do anything within his power to save the woman he loves, but he's not powerful enough. He doesn't know enough. But he will seek out that power and knowledge wherever he can, even if that means from those in the dark side of the Force. He determines that he must do what it takes to achieve that power and that knowledge. His closest friends warned him, no, you do not want to go down that path. It only leads to death and destruction. But he is determined that that is the way that he must go. It is the only chance that he has to save the ones that he loves. However, through this quest for power and this quest for knowledge, he ultimately brings about the death that he had been seeking and working so hard to prevent. He had chosen his way, but like he'd been warned, that way led only to death. Many of us can relate to this story. Maybe your loved ones didn't die at the end. But each of us has determined our own way. Each of us have scanned the horizons and looked at our options and decided this is the way that I must go. Be it right or be it wrong, we've each forged our own path to bring about the outcomes that we desire. Each of us has determined for ourselves what is true and what is right. However, as we can see from Anakin's tale, even the most well-intentioned paths aren't always right. As we've been studying through the book of John over the last past 6 weeks, we've seen many declarations and statements from Jesus. We've seen that he is the bread of life. He is the light of the world, and he is the true vine. As we conclude this sermon series this morning, we come to John chapter 14. It was on the night that Jesus was to be betrayed and arrested. He had gathered together with his disciples to celebrate the Passover meal, trying to explain to them one last time what is about to happen. He tells them in verses 2 through 4, "My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." If you're a little confused by that last statement, you're in good company. Jesus' disciples, they weren't the super scholarly of the time. They were your average Joe. And Jesus said many things that at the time went completely over their heads. But just like many of us, when someone says something and we're supposed to get it, but we don't, they just kind of smiled and nodded and kind of went along with it, hoping that their ignorance would not become obvious. However, in this case, Thomas, who was not one to let anything go without his comprehension, spoke up, saying, "Lord, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way?" I mean, if you don't know where you're going, you can't know how to get there. It was through this question of doubt that we receive one of the most profound statements of Christ. In John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus makes a declaration that is unprecedented, a statement that only he is qualified to make truthfully. Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Now, this was a controversial statement in those days, but it's even more so now. In today's era of inclusiveness, we fight to ensure that nobody is left out and that everybody's ideas are validated. In this spirit of inclusiveness, many declare that there is no one way to heaven, but instead each of us must find our own path. Maybe you find your way through Buddha while I find my way through Jesus, and yet someone else may find their way through Allah and the prophet Muhammad. Every way is validated, and every belief is considered to be true. However, as we discussed last fall, this cannot be the case. In the spirit of inclusiveness, we like to declare that all beliefs are true and that all truth is therefore relative, but in reality, this can't be the case. To demonstrate this, we looked at a tactic coined by Dr. Frank Turek as the Roadrunner tactic. And this tactic seeks to apply a claim to itself to show that it has no ground upon which to stand. All truth is relative, In order to apply the Roadrunner tactic to this claim, we simply ask the question, is that a relative truth? The claim that all truth is relative seeks to apply itself to all other truths, and therefore is a claim to absolute truth. This claim seeks to apply itself to other truths, yet claims that no truth can do so. In our study of the topic of truth, we tackled the age-old phrase, it's true for you, but not for me. This is at the heart of this inclusive, every way leads to God mindset. However, if we apply the Roadrunner tactic, we find that it's true for you, but not for me can't be true. Because it's true for you, but not for me is, again, a claim to absolute truth while claiming that there is no absolute truth. And therefore, it can't be true. If somebody says to you, it's true for you, but not for me, a fun way to combat this argument is to simply tell them, why don't you go try that with your bank teller? You know, times are tough, and so you walk into the bank and you tell them, I'd like to withdraw $10,000. They take your account information, they type it all in, and they say, I'm sorry, but it looks like you only have $36.27 in your account. Just simply tell them, well, that's true for you, but not for me. Just give me the 10 grand. See how well that works. If it's true that you only have $36.27, it's not a matter of my truth versus your truth. It's just a matter of the truth. It's absurd to think of it in that way, but when it comes to inconvenient truths, such as I am the way, the truth, and the life, suddenly we get this idea that we can pick and choose what truth is. If Jesus is the way, as he claims, then Allah and Buddha can't be the way. And likewise, vice versa. We've seen plenty of evidence to back up this idea that Jesus is who he claimed to be. I don't have time to go into it all this morning, but if you're interested, we went all over this last fall. And if you check out our website, BeulahNazarene.com, just search for the Prove It series, all the information is there. But if Jesus truly is God, as he claimed, then he is the way. What does this mean? Suppose you're in a new town, and your GPS has completely gone awry. You cannot rely upon it whatsoever, but you're on a deadline. You have to get to where you're going. And so you do the one thing that every man is sworn to never do. You stop. And you ask for directions. I know you're not supposed to do it, but you're on a deadline. You have to. You have no other choice. And so you stop and you find somebody. And you ask them, how do I get here? And they tell you, well, if you just head down this street here, take a right at the second stoplight, go about 3 blocks and take another right, and then keep going down that road and just past the bank, you'll see where you need to be on the left-hand side. In that moment, that person has told you the way. Chances are you're going to be lost before you get halfway there. However, if that person says instead, follow me, I will get you to where you are going. In that sense, that person has become the way. You cannot miss your destination. You may not know where your destination is, but if you follow them, you will get there. That is what Jesus does. He doesn't simply give us directions and advice on how to reach the Father. Instead, he takes us by the hand and he leads us day in and day out. He strengthens and he guides us. He doesn't simply tell us the way. He is the way. You may say, well, that's all good and well, but why should I believe that Jesus is the way at all? Muhammad claimed that he knew the way. And that's true. But once again, you have to look at the evidence behind each claim. As I said, we have much evidence that the narrative given by the New Testament is true. Likewise, Jesus not only claims to be the way, he also makes claim to being truth itself. Truth can be known. We all inherently know this to be true. It's self-defeating to say that it can't. Many men have come and they have claimed to know the truth, but no man has embodied it like Jesus. See, there's a striking importance to moral truth. If a man stands before you and tries to teach you Spanish or calculus or astronomy, the moral character of that man is irrelevant. A man can still teach you calculus if he's cheated on his wife. That has no bearing on being able to teach you that truth. However, if a man claims to be and teach moral truth, the moral character of that man is of utmost importance. A thief that teaches the importance of property ownership, or an adulterer that stresses the importance of purity, will not be effective. Moral truth cannot be conveyed merely by words, but it must be lived out in the real world. And that is precisely what Jesus did. Many great men and women can say, "I have taught you the truth," but only Jesus can say, "I am the truth." Not only has the statement of moral perfection found its peak in Jesus, but the fact of moral perfection has found its realization in him. Jesus has also declared that he is the life. If there's one thing that mankind seeks above all else, it is life. Even our quest for knowledge is not a quest for knowledge itself, but a quest for that which makes life worth living. A writer may, in his novel, create a character that falls in love with another only to say, "I never knew what life was until I found it in your love." Love brings life. This is what Jesus does. He brings abundant life to those who are dead. Jesus puts it this way: "No one comes to the Father except through me." See, Jesus is the way to God. We can make our own way by following Allah or Buddha or trying to do enough good things. But just like Anakin Skywalker, our best efforts, our own way, will only lead to death. Only in Jesus can we see who God is and what he's like. Only through Jesus can we find our way to the throne of God without fear and without shame. Only through him will we know the truth and have life. Jesus Christ is the way and the truth and the life. He's the only one that could claim that because that is who he is. You don't have to believe it. There are many people in this world who don't. Jesus gives us the freedom to completely reject him. You can go about your life believing that every way leads to eternal life, or that if you do enough good things, or if you're a good enough person, that you'll earn it. However, you can't deny that Jesus has said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. You can't deny the life that he has lived. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. The only question remaining is whether or not you're going to follow that truth, or if you will choose to remain in darkness. There are really no other choices. Either you accept him for who he is, or reject him for your own reality. The choice is up to you. On this Easter morning, as we celebrate the new life that we have in Christ's resurrection, this is the question that each of us has to wrestle with ourselves. Are we going to forge our own path? Are we going to try and make our own way? Or will we trust in the one who has said that he is the way? Again, there's really only the two choices. Either you accept him or you reject him. And he gives us the freedom to do both. If you haven't made that decision for yourself, I would ask that you take some time and that you ponder this. That you look at all the evidence, that you look at the claims, that you look at the life of Jesus, that you look within your own life and see the truth for what it really is. This morning, we'll be partaking in the sacrament of communion. This is a reaffirmation of the covenant that Jesus made with us. For those that have accepted Christ's sacrifice and believe in him and trust in him, this sacrament is a reaffirmation of that commitment. We are proclaiming Christ's sacrifice on our behalf and our acceptance and our appreciation for the price that he was willing to pay to go to that cross of his own accord and to lay down his life. Jesus himself ordained this holy sacrament. He commanded his disciples to partake of the bread and the wine, emblems of his body and his blood. While we in the Church of the Nazarene don't require that you be a member in order to partake, we do require that you have accepted his sacrifice, that you believe in him. There are no age requirements or other stipulations, just a right relationship with God. As the music plays, I would ask if there is anything between you and God, if you're on your own path, maybe you've let that relationship fall away. I would ask that you make it right. That you take some time right now to speak with our Lord and Savior, to accept the redemption that he offers. And when you are ready, I would ask that you make your way down the center aisle, receive the elements, and go back to your seats. And once everyone has received the elements, we will all partake together. Lord Jesus, Lord, you are the way. You have declared it yourself. That though others may come and preach a different gospel, Lord, your gospel is the only true gospel. The only way to our Heavenly Father without shame and without fear, without experiencing his wrath, is through you, his one and only Son, that has sacrificed himself. You might redeem the world to him. Lord, I pray that we would celebrate your resurrection. That, Lord, we may take joy in the grace and the mercy that you have poured out on us, that we may declare from the rooftops every good and perfect thing that you've done, that we will let this whole world know who you are. The Lord, any other way leads to death, but through you we can find life. Lord, go with us from this place. Guide us and direct us. May your light shine in our lives and in and through us every day. In your name we pray. Amen.